Good morning. Welcome to worship here at the Reformed Church of Stout. Just a couple of announcements, highlights actually. The first is, if you've noticed in the narthex, we put together a mailbox for our church family. If you are in the church directory, you will get a box automatically once I get figured out how to print up the names. But if you're not in the church directory and would still like to have a mailbox, please let me know and we'll just add you to the list. Secondly, we as a consistory decided at consistory meeting that if you feel now that you don't want to wear a mask here to worship at the Reformed Church of Stout, that is fine. If you want to, that is absolutely fine as well. We just ask that we continue to social distance and most of all just be conscientious of one another and that we would all stay healthy and safe. Are there any other announcements? If not, I've realized that I've been slacking off with the dad jokes. I heard this one a couple weeks ago. It comes from Dale Ackerman. You know, our country, we're in turmoil, aren't we? I mean, we can't agree on anything, it don't seem like. But Dale said this, if every American would buy a pink car, what would we have? A pink carnation. So there we go. I thought that was appropriate for springtime. Darlis, don't look away. If it's good, it came from me. If you don't like it, it's Dale's there. So, all right. Let's stand for our call to worship, and then we'll have opening prayer, and we'll sing our opening hymn, O Worship the King. Let's stand. Bless the Lord, O my soul. And all that is within me, bless his holy name. Let's pray. Father, indeed, we have come to worship and to bless you. Lord, may the words that we speak and sing, the words that we hear, the music that we hear, may it all be a pleasure and a blessing to you, because it is from you that all blessings flow. Amen. O worship the King. Us this morning and also greet each other from a distance. And then you may be seated. Trying to see who looks guilty. This is laying in the front pew, and on it says, hint, hint. So it's, well, it's not Norma because she just got it. That's cute. Do I get to keep this? Uh-oh. There we go. All right, we got it. Oh, you don't know how well this is all going to fit in at the end of the service, buddy. All right? It is a good time, and we are glad to be here, and my helper is not here. Oh, my goodness. Kelton, come here. Kids, come on up. Hint, hint. Oh, my goodness. It is a sermon. Somebody didn't listen. We're short of help or short of kids. See what I got in there? What is it?
Dirt.
Yeah, but what's this? You know what kind? Corn plant. Yep. So you guys, yeah, come on up. Don't be shy. So there's all sorts of topics that I could talk about, but this morning, even with this illustration, but this morning I've got something planted in there, and if you see this little seedling growing up there, okay, that's a corn plant, but I also noticed we got some Butler County weeds growing, and there's even some little rocks. All right, Kelton, hold that, will you? Stand up here. Okay, we're going to make a mess, all right, or try and... Oh, there's one still trying to grow. All right. Thank you, sir. Let's dig around here a little bit. Okay. So, you can show them guys that. Let them look nice and close, okay? All right. Got it? Yeah, don't drop it. Okay. So if you look really close, where the dirt clump is, there's a little seed, and that's where that plant started to grow from, okay? That is the source of that plant. Kelton, how long do you think it's going to take for this seed, if we'd let it grow, if it was outside, for it to be so tall that it'd be above our head? About how long? Okay, by fall it would be. About maybe by the 4th of July, it probably, you know, they used to say, Nehi, you can sit down if you want to. But yeah, that plant grows really rapidly. In 6 months, it goes from a seedling to a mature plant, okay? And this morning we're going to talk about something that Jesus talked about, another kind of seed, and what it develops into and what it is used for. But for us, we need to remember that God has planted a seed in our heart, the seed of the gospel of Jesus Christ, of how much he loves us, okay? And we need to make sure that we keep feeding and watering that seed, taking care of it, and letting it grow, okay? Give you your snacks. And they're all different, so if you guys want to exchange when you get home or later on, whatever. All right, let's pray. Dear Jesus, just thank you for the seeds that you have sown in our heart, the seed of faith and of love. And Lord, I just pray especially for these young people, Lord, that that seed would continue to grow and to develop, Lord, and that one day they too would grow up to be strong, not only with their bodies, but especially with their love for you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, thanks, Kelton. You can go back. All right, our special music is given by Kim and Nolan, and it's entitled Come As You Are.
Thank you.
sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, oh sinner, come kneel. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. Oh, I'm broken, lift up your face. So lay down your hurt, lay down your heart, come as you are. There's hope for the hopeless and all those who've strayed. Come sit at the table, come taste the grace. There's rest for the weary, rest that endures. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't cure. So lay down your burdens, lay down your shame. How do I know you can lift up your face? Sinner, be still. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. So lay down.
What burdens do we have in our life? I want you to think about that a little bit. And then I'd like you, if you'd like to follow along, page 118 in the Old Testament. I'm going to read the Ten Commandments because I don't think I've ever read them while I've been here. And so we're going to do so at this time. Exodus chapter 20, beginning with verse 1, and I'm going to read just a little bit further than actually the words of the Ten Commandments. Hear these words. And God spoke all these words: I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an idol in the form of anything in heaven above, or in the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sins of the fathers to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of your Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you nor your son or daughter, nor your manservant or your maidservant, nor your animals, nor the alien within your gates. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them, but he rested on the seventh day. Therefore the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and he made it holy. Honor your father and your mother so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God has given you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife or his manservant or maidservant, his ox or donkey or anything that belongs to your neighbor. And when the people saw the thunder and the lightning, and heard the trumpet, and saw the mountain in smoke, they trembled with fear. They stayed at a distance and said to Moses, "Speak to us yourself, and we will listen. But do not have God speak to us, or we will die." Those very words, as we call the Ten Commandments, can be a burden to us, can't they? If we allow Satan to twist them and to twist how we think and how we feel, they become a burden, because then we try to do it ourselves. And we look to God and we look to him in fear. We see the smoke and the fire and we hear the trumpet and the noise of God, and we fear, and we feel as though the Israelites said, we can't even come before him. But see, our burden has been lifted at Calvary. Everything has been taken care of. We can come before God, even in our sinful condition, with confidence and assurance that he's not out to get us, that he doesn't want to get even, that he doesn't hate us, but that he loves us and he cares about us so much that he gave us his son, Jesus Christ. That is the God we serve, not a God of burdens, but a God of love. Before I get preaching on another subject, let's so ask God to bless the reading of our scripture that we're going to read from Mark chapter 4 this morning. Father, we come before you. We are unworthy to come before you in our own stance, in our own state. But because of your Son, we can come freely. We praise you for your Son who kept that law perfectly. We praise you for the prophets that shared it with us, that we can still look at it, that we can read the words, that we can understand that we in no way can keep those laws. But Lord, let us live in the love of your Son, Jesus Christ. May we live by those two commandments that he gave when he said, love the Lord your God with all your heart and love your neighbor as yourself. May we keep that in mind even as we read your scripture today. In Jesus' name, amen. Our scripture is from Mark chapter 4, beginning with verse 26, and I'm going to read through verse 34. It's found on 1558 in your Bibles if you'd like to follow along. He, Jesus, said, "This is what the kingdom of God is like. A man scatters seed on the ground. Night and day, whether he sleeps or gets up, the seed sprouts and it grows, though he does not know how. All by itself, the soil produces grain, first the stalk, then the head, and then the full kernel in the head. As soon as the grain is ripe, he puts the sickle to it, because the harvest has come." And again he said, "What shall we say the kingdom of God is like? Or what parable shall we use to describe it? It is like a mustard seed, which is the smallest of all seeds on the earth. Yet when it's planted, it grows and becomes the largest of all garden plants, with such big branches that the birds can perch in its shade. With many similar parables, Jesus spoke the word to them as much as they could understand. But he did not say anything to them without using a parable. But when he was alone with his disciples, he explained everything. Amen. Since it's planting season here in Iowa, I thought it would be appropriate that we talk about planting a little bit this morning. We all understand what it's like or what it means to plant some seeds, whether we're a farmer or a gardener or maybe we're just a novice and we just watch others do their thing in their gardens. Our neighbors in the backyard put a lot of effort and time into their gardens. It is something that I'm sure they're very proud of. In the last couple weeks, it's kind of amusing, at least to me, to watch them bring out all their sheets and their blankets and cover up the plants late in the evening. And then, you know, they take them off in the morning and the next time they do the same thing. Now, last night they didn't cover them. And when I woke up, my AccuWeather thing said it was 26 degrees here. So I'm not sure what happened to them this morning. But we understand it takes a lot of effort, a lot of time. We understand that those little seeds that we plant, they turn out nothing like them when they grow up into a mature plant. We look forward to that fall harvest, that reward that we can have. Those first green beans and potatoes. Those first BLT sandwiches. We have something to look forward to when we plant. In this morning's text, we find Jesus speaking what I call the farmer parables. And there are three of them. The first one I didn't read. It's about the four soils. And I'm sure you can remember that in October of 2019, I shared the four soil parables with you. And I'm sure you know exactly what I said back then. But this morning, there's two more parables. The parable of the growing seed and the parable of the mustard seed. I'd like to take them in reverse order. I'd like to look at that mustard seed parable first and see what we can glean from it. Jesus begins by saying, "What shall we say the kingdom of God is like?" He's trying to show these people what God's kingdom is like. But why does he say we? Why doesn't he say, "What can I say?" Actually, because, right, Jesus is the one telling the story. Jesus is the one giving the lesson. His disciples have no part of this teaching. I believe it shows that Jesus is always working with his Father and the Holy Spirit in everything that he does. And he points that out to these people that are listening on that day. He goes into this story about this mustard seed and he says it's the smallest seed in the world. Does anybody know how big a mustard seed is? By the way, the mustard seed that Jesus is talking about is not the type of mustard that we used to have out in the oats fields, you know? I can remember when we had oats and that mustard would come up and it'd flower, and Dad would be sure that I would have to go and get those because that was bad news to have that in our oats field. But this mustard seed we talk or read about is mentioned five times in the Bible, three times in parables and two times just in Jesus' ministry. It is about 1 millimeter long or wide, the smallest seed that is known of mankind is 0.05 milliliters. And there are those out there that would critique or ridicule Jesus for saying, "You're telling a story and you can't even get your facts right. Why would you tell the people that it's the smallest seed when it isn't?" You see, we need to go back and we need to understand who Jesus is talking to. He's talking to some Jews. And to the Jews, the mustard seed was the smallest seed that they used in their gardens or in their planting. If he were coming to teach this parable to us today, he might use a carrot seed or a radish or possibly an alfalfa seed. You see, Jesus was always relating to the people that he was talking to. His teachings always dealt with them. He brought the gospel into their world, not the other way around. So Jesus now, he gives this example that people would plant that small seed and that it would grow. He tells that this seed turns into a tree, a fortress, if you will, tall and mighty and strong. It says that even the birds can find refuge in its branches. These birds, if you will, or the mentioning of them, is all part of what we would call Jesus' road to rest. In Matthew 6, we read that the birds of the field gather nothing, yet God takes care of them. In Luke chapter 9, he says these words, "The foxes have dens and the birds have nests, but the Son of Man has no place to lay his head." You see, even in this parable, Jesus is trying to show the people that he is talking to that God is taking care of them. Through everything, in everything, even in ways that they may not think about or understand. The parable goes deeper than first meets the eye. It has that literal meaning, if you will, of small faith growing into something bigger. But it also brings out the idea that Jesus is all about the future. That seed that is planted does not stay in the ground. That seed that sprouts does not stay small. That seed matures. It becomes large. It grows mightily. Mark, in his no-nonsense way of speaking, makes it very clear that we as Christians are not to stay immature, that we are to grow just like the seeds of Jesus' parable. But that is not the end. In verse 29, we read this, "As soon as the grain is ripe, he puts a sickle to it because the harvest has come." Whether you plant a garden or you plant a field of corn, you understand that that corn planter is not the last piece of equipment that's going to be in that field that year. We understand that we plant with the hopes of a harvest. And so it is with Jesus in this parable. So it is with Jesus in the kingdom of God. He explains how the harvest is coming, how the sickle will be brought to bring in the grain. To me, the fullness of farming explained by Jesus fits so very well with his kingdom. But as I was doing my studies this week, I came upon these verses from Revelation chapter 14, and I'd like to read them now. This is John speaking, and he says, "I looked, and there before me was a white cloud, and seated on that cloud was like the Son of Man." As farmers, I think we've all seen those white clouds in the sky, those clouds that come billowing over the horizon with its thunder, with its majesty, but also with that fear of what is coming with those clouds. And then it says this, "And the cloud was like the Son of Man, with a crown of gold on his head and a sharp sickle in his hand. Then another angel came out of the temple and called with a loud voice to him who was sitting on the cloud. And he said, 'Take your sickle and reap, because the time to reap has come, for the harvest on this earth is ripe.' So he who was seated on the clouds swung his sickle over the entire earth, and the earth was harvested. We as Christians understand that time on this earth at some point is going to come to an end. We understand as Christians that our lives at some point, if Jesus doesn't come relatively soon, are going to come to an end. There's going to be a time of separation, a time of separating the grain from the chaff, the good plants from the weeds, the sheep from the goats. There will be an absolute judgment, a final judgment, with no second chances at that point. A scene that almost makes us shudder. Less for Jesus Christ. See, because of Him, we also have an assurance, a hope, a guarantee that we, when that harvest comes, will be with Him forever. The earlier, or the first parable that Jesus talks about how that plant grows day and night without any help of the person that has planted it. And we too understand that as farmers, we sometimes say the corn, you can almost hear it grow or see it grow. But it grows all the time, doesn't it, if the weather's right? It grows while we're sleeping, it grows while we're awake, it grows while we're there watching, and it grows while we're somewhere far away. And so it is with God's kingdom. Jesus says we are to plant the seeds and then we are to let the rest up to God. We are to understand where we are in our life, what our job is in the kingdom of God, but we also need to understand that there are some things that are not meant for us to do. As I was studying this week, the Ten Commandments kept coming back and back to me. Those Ten Commandments that we were taught in Sunday school and in catechism. Those Ten Commandments with those words of thou shalt not, thou shalt not, thou shalt not. Maybe it's just me, but there was a time in my life I got caught up in the thou shalt nots. I was so worried about making sure that I didn't do anything to upset God that I was not taking care of what I was supposed to be. It was so important for me to have a good reputation, for me to look good in front of everybody. It was so important for me to make sure that Mom and Dad didn't find out that I did anything wrong because I didn't want to disappoint them. Now, God's Word, God's Ten Commandments are so very important. And I'm not trying to put them down in any way, shape, or form. But if we are doing that, if that is the focus of our attention, of our daily walk with Jesus, then we are missing out on what He truly wants us to do. You see, that harvest that is coming, God knows the day that it is coming. God also knows that there are many souls out there who are yet to be reached. It is our job to go and to share the good news. To take those seeds that we would take, even if we were planting a garden, and to plant them no matter what. If you've been out working in your garden or been working in your farm this spring, you know that it's very dry. It's almost terribly dry. Maybe one of the driest springs I can ever remember, especially this early on. But as farmers, as gardeners, do we put our tools and machinery away? Do we pack the seed bags away and say, well, there's no use. We'll just call it a year and we'll see what next year brings. No. We go out and we plant the seed, having faith that God will send the sunshine and the rain. And so it is with our daily walk, our spiritual walk with God. He says, go. Plant the seeds. Let me do the rest. Let me develop that seed into a tall and mighty plant. Let me make sure it reaches maturity. let me take the sickle to it at harvest time. In the meantime, we have one more thing that we need to do. We need to keep growing in our faith. We need to keep maturing as Christians. We need to let the Spirit move us more and more and more. With these things, I believe God's kingdom will come to an end. When these things are accomplished and God's harvest is ripe, we will meet Him in glory. So whether you run like a deer, or follow the international harvester, our goal is the same. I told you, Larry, I was going to use that. That's amazing. We have one goal to unite us. At the beginning of the service, I told that joke, kind of tongue-in-cheek. But Jesus Christ is the uniter. He is the only uniter. His way is the only way. May His will be done in your life and in mine. Amen. Our hymn of application is an old hymn that I haven't sung for a very long time, Bringing in the Sheaves. Going in the morning, sowing seeds of kindness, sowing in the noontime and the new eve, waiting for the harvest and the time of reaping, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves. Sowing in the sunshine, sowing in the shadows, fearing neither clouds nor winter chilling breeze. Quiet by the harvest and the labor ended, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves. Bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves. Bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves. Going forth with leaping, sowing for the Master, though the loss sustained our spirit often grieves. When our weeping's over, He will bid us welcome, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves. Bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves. Bringing in the sheaves, bringing in the sheaves, we shall come rejoicing, bringing in the sheaves.
Amen. You may be seated.
As we come to our time of sharing with our Father those that are on our hearts and our minds, I'll just give you a couple things. We do praise God for several good reports that people from our congregation have received concerning their health issues. We also are mindful of many who continue to have health issues in our doctrine. We'll pray for their healing as well. I put in this week to pray for our children and grandchildren. As a prayer group, when we gather each time, we pray for them. And it was made obvious the last couple times that our children are really in harm's way, if you will, especially spiritually. The many things that are going on in their lives outside their home life. So we'll pray for them, and we will pray for continued peace in America. So does anyone have anything else to share? Yes, Carolyn. Okay, Sandy Dannenbrink passed away of cancer, so we'll pray for her family. Anything else? Yeah, Vernon.
On the news this week, I believe today, we're talking about Guatemala, and this will be the second year of a total drought there. We think it's dry.
Right. Yes, in Guatemala, they have not had a crop in 2 years, and it is still just terribly dry there. So, anything else? If not, let's come before our Father and let's pray. Father, indeed, we thank you for being a God that blesses us so richly. Lord, we thank you this morning for this building that you have given us. The beauty of it, Lord, that we can worship and praise your holy name. That we can gather together as believers for fellowship. And for fun. Lord, we thank you for all those things. We thank you for being a God who cares. We thank you, Lord, for being with the farmers as they began planting this year's crop. Lord, we do pray that you would send showers of rain, if it be your will, to bless the soil, to saturate it, that the seedlings may grow. Lord, we understand as farmers that we plant the seed and we maybe do a few other little things to help it, but ultimately it comes from you. So we leave it in your hands. We thank you, Lord, for being with those of our congregation who have been going through medical issues, for the good reports you have given to several. Lord, we just thank you for that. We thank you for healing for those that have needed healing. We continue to pray, Lord, for those who need you, for those who are still doctoring and seeking answers and solutions. Lord, may they come quickly. Lord, we just pray too that all of us, whatever our medical history may be, whatever our problems may be, that we would put them in your hands as the great physician. Lord, we just pray especially for the Sandy's family, Lord, as she has passed away. Just bring blessing to them during this difficult time. We think, too, of people, Lord, far, far away who are struggling. We think of those, especially in Guatemala, Lord. As we understand the need for rain here, we pray as well that you would bless their soil with rain, that you would bring new life to their country, to their land. Lord, we thank you so much for our children, our grandchildren, our great-grandchildren. Lord, they are such a blessing in our lives. And we love them dearly, just as you do. Lord, we also understand that we cannot be with them to protect them all the time. And so, Lord, we pray that you will bless them, that you will keep them close to you. Lord, we just pray that those people that are around them when we are not would be godly as well, that they would have their best interest in mind. Lord, we pray for this great country, the United States of America. We pray for peace. We pray for justice. Lord, not justice that we see in our minds, but justice that comes from you. Lord, I just thank you for those men and women who are out there on the front lines every day doing their jobs to protect us, to help us. We pray, Lord, that you will keep them safe. The firefighters, the EMTs, the nurses, the doctors, our police. There are so many others, Lord. We just thank you for them. Thank you for their time and their effort. Thank you that they love their fellow people so much that they're willing to put their own lives on the line. We thank you too, Lord, for our military, for those who continue to serve this country to protect our freedom. Lord, I just pray too that you would be with our shut-ins, our those who are confined to their own homes. Lord, we thank you that the pandemic has eased somewhat, that restrictions have been lessened, and that we can go and visit them. Lord, I just pray that we would spend extra time with them, for it has been over a year since they've really had anyone to visit with. Lord, I just thank you for their hard work, their dedication, for what they did to lay the groundwork for what we enjoy today. Lord, may they be blessed by you. May they understand that we appreciate it so very much, even though often we don't say it. And Lord, that's the way it is with you as well. You bless us so very much, and so many times it's so easy just to kind of go on with our daily lives, the hustle and the bustle, and to forget that it all comes from you. So right now, Lord, in a moment of silence, let us lift up our praises and thanksgiving to you. Lord, most of all, we thank you for your Son, Jesus Christ, for all that he did, for lifting our burden, every single one of them, that we may come before you. And Lord, we thank you for this avenue of prayer which he gave us as well when he taught us these words: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Again, this morning, the offering plates are in the rear of the sanctuary. At this time, let's stand for our doxology and offertory prayer. Father, we bring these gifts before you, relying in the promise that little is much with you in it. So, Lord, now we bring these tokens of our appreciation, of our gratitude before you. Multiply them mightily into the furtherance of thy kingdom's work. In Jesus' name, amen. Our closing hymn is number 702, Christ for the World We Sing.
Things take and sorrow more.
Hear this benediction. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we could ask or ever imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. And all God's people said, Amen. Our closing chorus, Sent Forth by God's Blessing.
Amen.